also on Amazon, The Class of 07, in its first season, is really strong. It is a kind of like Last Man on Earth. It is a kind of an apocalyptic comedy, but certainly not as dark. And I think part of the reason that it works is that the characters aren't that much in a state of doom. At one point, they have no food and are forced to eat shoes, which simply doesn't make sense. But for some reason, it doesn't come with a sense of we are screwed. It's not like the film Alive or something. And it's a very delicate balance. I think the characters are mostly preoccupied with their high school drama because, like a TV show like last year's After Party, it's all about kind of reliving your traumas in your past and trying to make sense of it and bridging friendships. I have to give the show a lot of credit for passing the Bechdel test, which is just, you know, a lot of these women are in their late 20s. You'd think some of them, their biggest concern of being stranded on an island would be romantic partners back home. And it's absolutely humongously important. Even there's like almost no gay subtext. These are not romantic relationships, but they are just simply female friendships that are being worked out and processed. And all of that gives a lot of pairings and permutations and combinations of characters that are really strong. And it's also a show that is from Australia, so it has a very regional flavor. There is one American character, and she's awful. And you know what? I'll bite the bullet on that. That's okay that we do not get a great portrayal on that show.
Talk to Daddy, talk to Daddy. He will rock you when you are sad. He isn't ideal, but you need to heal so.
In the second season of the Saturday Night Live produced musical parody featuring Keegan Michael Key and Cecily Strong and a lot of Broadway heavy hitters such as Kristen Chenoweth, Alan Cumming, Dove Cameron, and Aaron Tveit, and Jane Krakowski in supporting roles. They did an American Horror Story kind of thing where they switched up the roles in the second season and they updated it thematically to represent a series of musicals that were both more freer in the lighter sense, such as Hair and Godspell, as well as darker musicals like the Bob Fosse, Stephen Sondheim stuff, like Pippin and Cabaret and Sweeney Todd. I am only familiar with a couple of these, but I think the best thing about the show is the extremely clever way in which they integrated all these musicals into one steady universe while also maintaining the parody and comedic aspect. I think Cecily Strong is absolutely brilliant. She is a comedian, in my estimation, of reaction. She does a lot of great reaction shots, reactionary comedy. I remember in the first season where she sleeps with Aaron Tveit and she's like, oh, that just happened. And she is a great kind of fish out of the water character. I felt that the ending was a little bit too epilogue heavy. I mean, you gotta know there's a happy ending, and that was a little bit, it was like, it went on for like 10 minutes, and then Titus Burgess, who's a narrator, he breaks character and seemingly goes back to being Titus Andragonus from the Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt with the same voice and the same sense of neediness for a partner, and I was really enjoying Titus Burgess being this completely different character who is very self-assured. But I think with the exception of the very last 10 minutes of the show, each episode was just very packed. It was only 6 episodes, which is a little disappointing considering the amount of material they have. But 6 episodes of a great show is better than 0 episodes of a great show.
0 to 60, 3.5. Baby, you got the keys. Now shut up and
drive. The show that I have been absolutely gobbling up is American Auto on NBC. It's by Justin Spitzer, who had the best training ground for writing kind of realistic workplace comedies of the 21st century as a writer under Greg Daniels with The Office, and then he created Superstore, which followed people in a big box store like Walmart or Target who stayed for years and years, which pretty much never happens. I once worked in a tea store and no one stayed more than 11 months, and it was actually a pretty decent job. So irony of the Superstore aiming for realism, and it got a lot of props for that from the media press and It had it had all kinds of hot button issues like undocumented immigrants, the stigma of divorce, dating a subordinate or whatever. But for me, the comedic gold of that show was just how the characters bickered and made any situation more complicated than it needed for anyone unlucky enough to take on the purgatory of middle management. And I think this is what he does so much better in this show, because it still has a lot of great class commentary, but the class commentary comes pretty much exclusively from the corporate buffoons at the top. In Superstore, they're played by, it's Dina and Glenn. In this show, the audience surrogates are put upon communications officer Sadie and the blue-collar worker Jack, who gets promoted upward through sheer dumb luck. And as the series progresses, though, they show signs of being more comfortable in their first class digs than they do being among the common people. So rather than poke fun at the rich and powerful for simply being rich and powerful, which is kind of the present-day method of criticism at people like Elon Musk or Jeff Bezos, American Auto presents these rich people as both being victims of their own detachment, but also being a product of an ecosystem of enhanced scrutiny, aka cancel culture, and increased demands on the shareholders. But most importantly, the characters are very funny and rich and very diverse. We have characters from different classes, but also different ways in which they got rich. Wesley, played by Ike Barinholtz's brother, John Barinholtz, is the descendant of the company's founder, and he basically is, if it was a first-class passenger of the Titanic, transported 110 years first in time in terms of his aloofness. And Anna Gasteyer is someone who worked her way up the corporate ladder and broke many glass ceilings, but still is pretty detached from the product in which she's selling. So I think it's a really brilliant show, and I was looking forward to it every week when it was on. You give them the games to play, to say, I want something else to get me through this semi-tone kind of life. Party Down just made a revival, and I think it's important to note that in 2009 when Party Down premiered, it was a bit of a game changer for the TV landscape. And this TV landscape, shows like Bored to Death and Louie, which would trade on this kind of like morose anyway and these characters that were sad and marked out as edgy comedy. In terms of Party Down, these were characters that were kind of depressed and sad and their lives weren't going any places, but this would be combined with a little bit of the Mike Schur, Greg Daniels kind of positivity of them having little mundane victories at work as small episodes where they might have some sort of success in playing a prank or finding some brief love connection or having a good time with the party thrower or feeling superior to the person throwing the party or make a little bit of a headway on a career advancement. And all these little things were and this made it so that this wasn't a complete, like, Murphy's Law sitcom. Also, the show really deserved a lot of credit for capturing creativity in all kinds of facets. You had someone who wanted to be a model or a rock star or a writer or own his own restaurant. So it wasn't just about actors being actors, and that's kind of too inside Hollywood-ish. That's Megan Mullally's best role, to be honest. And this show also adds Zoe Chow and Tyler James Williams from Brockmire and Everybody Hates Chris to the mix, and it's great that they represent creative people who have different definitions of creativity. Zoe Chow is like an experimental chef who really gets into the experimental side of things. She doesn't even like things that taste good. That's how avant-garde she is. And Tyler James Williams is a YouTube influencer. And one of the most jarring and funny scenes is that Jane Lynch doesn't even take him seriously as someone with dreams. So it's definitely a commentary on all that. And I think that the new season definitely focuses on happiness at a higher level than Mansell's hierarchy needs, since these guys have had some success. And it's not necessarily as much of a show operating on, you know, downer endings and, you know, that kind of anyway. Meet me up past the cotton woods where we ran
as kids. Straight out past. So the latest creation of Rian Johnson, who really is a big name in Hollywood, especially with the Knives Out, Glass Onion, 1-2 Punch, but also dating back to Looper, he did one of the Star Wars, he he did Brick, The Brothers Bloom, is a sort of a mystery, episodic mystery called Poker Face, starring Natasha Lyonne, who really is one of the, probably the biggest breakout star from Orange is the New Black. And she plays a detective who basically is Columbo, if you remember the 1970s series, because she sounds and talks like Columbo. I'm not sure why she didn't just kind of create her own character, but whatever. The series is good enough that I'm willing to overlook it. So anyway, Natasha Lyonne's character, Charlie Kale, is a drifter. She was working in Las Vegas, or some town with a lot of casinos, and she kind of got in the Bob's bad side, and ended up just trying to make a living for herself from town to town, and just kind of falling into trouble in the same way that sort of like those USA shows like Monk and Psych do all the time. Like a lot of the Rian Johnson movies, the film has a very strong sense of place, mostly kind of drifting through towns in what appears to be the American Southwest. The because Rian Johnson's a very hot ticket, we have a lot of great actors who are signing up to do this series, even in small roles, like Benjamin Bratt, Adrian Brody, Ellen Barkin, Joseph Gordon-Levitt, a frequent collaborator, Chloe Sevigny, Tim Blake Nelson, Judith Light, Nick Nolte. I did not know he was still alive. There's someone named Pedro Hollywood, which I think we really need to spend a couple minutes discussing whether that's his actual name. I would love to investigate that. I would say that the show, as a serialized show, basically she's running away from the mob, and the mob kind of plays a cat and mouse game where they're kind of closer and then farther away from her and almost catch up to her. That's not as interesting as the procedural element, the sort of mystery of every episode. And there's also an interesting inversion of the trope where the detective always gets the guy at the end of the episode, because it doesn't always happen. And there's also the question of whether we as the audience are meant to root for the bad guy to get away, and whether we think Charlie really wants that to happen and what motivates her. She's not a detective who has to get every bad person, and she kind of has her own intrinsic intrinsic motivation in each case for wanting justice. So it's all very interesting. Come out to California, get out here fast as you can. We're all happy in California. Come on, stick your toes in.